What's something that someone remembers from the discussion last time? Okay. Let's first start out by defining tags. All right. Tags, again, are what tell the web browser what a particular piece of content means. And notice I'm using a specific word there. I'm saying what it means, not what it's going to look like. All right. There certainly are some default behaviors for that browsers have regarding tags, but the specifics of how it looks like really depends on both the browser and any CSS code that you write. And we'll get into CSS code later today. So a better way to put it is to say that a tags define the meaning of a particular piece of content. It tells the browser what it means. So for example, we saw headlines before, or headers before. We saw lists. We saw list items. We saw paragraphs. All of those are describing to the browser what those words meant in between them. All right. So that was that's sort of a summary of the idea of tags. All right. What do tags look like? Okay. Exactly. They start with a greater than sign, they end with a less than sign, and they have the name of the tag in between it. And for example, one of the tags that we went over last time was the H1 tag. So, H1, this would say that this is a top level heading. All right, so all the tags are going to look like this. It's going to be a less than sign, a greater than sign, and between them, there is going to be the name of the tag. Now, later on, in fact, later on today, we're going to learn that there could be other stuff between the greater than and less than sign. But there's at least going to be the name of the tag in there. And that, again, tells the browser what that tag is. And what the tag is tells the browser what that tag means, what that content means. All right? Yes.
Mm-hmm. If you wanted to show the greater than or less than sign in like paragraph text.
Excellent question. If you wanted to show the greater than or less than sign in your paragraph text, remind me, and I'll do it when we're going over this, but essentially you use this. Ampersand LT ampersand GT. Because if you put a greater than or less than sign, it assumes it's a tag otherwise. So like if you wanted to say like you use the H1 tag for this, you would use this. There's a whole set of special codes in HTML. And as the course progresses, we'll talk about probably a few of them. But if you Google HTML special codes, it will show you a list of all of the ones that are available. For example, a lot of these things are things that don't have a corresponding key on the keyboard, like the British pound sign instead of the dollar sign, or the euro sign, or like the trademark sign or the copyright sign. So if you Google HTML special codes, you'll see a whole list of them. And if you scroll down here, yeah, here's the greater than or less than sign, and the code that you do it is greater than LT, greater than GT. Good question. What else do we know about tags? Do tags get lonely? Well, that's a good question.
Yeah.
All right. Well, yeah. Tags really don't get lonely because just about every tag has an ending tag associated with it. So there's going to be a start tag and an ending tag. And that tells the browser, like, what where the start of the heading is, where the end of the heading is, or where the start of the paragraph is, or where the end of the paragraph is. Or like later on today when we talk about links, where the start of the link is, where the end of the link is. So, an ending tag is differentiated by the same sort of format for the tag, except there is a slash in front of the H1. So that's the ending tag. And almost always, tags come in pairs where you have a starting tag and an ending tag. And it's, again, that simply brackets the content on the page that that tag relates to. All right? And this is true of all tags, not just H1. All right? White space. White space, again, is anything that isn't a typed character. It would be like a space or a return or an enter or anything like that. And in a nutshell, those don't matter to the browser. The browser disregards them and sort of changes them to just one character. That gives me the advantage of I can lay out my code in a way that's going to make it more readable. Remember that a goal of anything that we do in web development or really any form of software development is to try to make our code maintainable, try to make our code easy to change. And one of the key things that we can do with HTML to make our code easy to change is have it formatted neatly. All right? You actually could write one long line of all your HTML code. Just start typing and not use any enters or any returns to put it on separate lines. And the browser would understand it. All right? The problem would be when you went back and tried to change it, it would be very confusing for you because it would be hard to see what belonged nested in what. And therefore, it's good to use white space to make your code more readable. And that includes things like indenting to show nesting. And what do I mean by nesting? I mean that when a tag starts in one tag, it ends in that same tag. The good example of that we had was head, title, notice that in this case, both the start and end title tag are contained within the head tag. That's what's known as properly nesting. All right? So the title tag starts within the head tag. And when I say within, what do I mean? I mean between the starting and ending tag. And therefore, the title tag, because it starts within the head tag, ends within the head tag. This is not proper nesting because the title tag starts inside the head tag and yet it ends outside of the head tag. So that's not legal. All right? When I say something is not legal, what I mean is it's breaking the rules. It would be like if you used a sentence that was grammatically incorrect, if you used a double negative or, you know, something like that. What happens when you break the rules of HTML? You don't know. Sort of all bets are off. Some of the rules, if you break them, depending on the circumstance, the browser may still figure out what it is that you want, and it might display the page properly. So even though you break the rules, it might still work out for you. In other cases, like we saw a case last time, if we had an incorrect end title tag, the browser doesn't know what to do with it, and it doesn't display your page at all. All right? So, really, a whole range of things could happen if you don't get your, if you don't follow all the rules of HTML. All right. I think that was most everything that we talked about last time. Are there any questions about any of this?
Zach, should I just have one question?
What's that?
Yep, Mr. Sellers. Yeah, you got my email, right, about my disability list?
Okay. Yes, I did. I was talking specifically about questions about this material. If you have, again, a more personal situation, it's probably best if you talk to me, like, during lab about that. So I'll get that back to you during lab.
Okay, that's cool.
All right. Any questions about HTML, tags, and so on? Okay. How many of you finished at least part of Lab 1? Okay, good. Good. All right. Let's go and let's create another example. Here's my goals for today. My goals for today are to do another example of creating a web page. We might pick another topic. I was going to do the NBA Finals, but I don't know if I feel like doing that one today.
Yeah, that's going on.
Yeah. So we'll pick something else. And so I want to repeat the process of creating a web page, all right, from scratch. All right. Then what I want to do is I want to introduce a few new things. Those will be what I will call the HTML5 structural elements, all right, and links and CSS. So that's the three new things that we want to add to the equation today. And that should be sufficient for you to complete the second part of Lab 1. So they want to have a topic that they want to do a web page on. Pick something fun. How about, let's do a web page about possums, all right? I used to think possums were really ugly and gross. I remember the first time I saw a possum, I pulled into my driveway, and my headlights flashed on it, and I just saw this creature staring at me, and it just gave me the creeps. But then a few years back, there was a possum when we had that really bad winter, so it was like several years back. There was a possum that like was always like walking around my porch, and I felt, me and my daughter felt so bad for it. We actually like left cat food out for it and fed this possum, and I think it really appreciated it. I really did. And there were also some stray cats in the neighborhood, and we tried to scare the stray cats away by feeding them, and that didn't work out too well. So let's do a web page on possums. And to do this, I'm going to copy stuff out of Wikipedia, because I don't really know anything about possums, right? So I'm going to pull up the possum page on Wikipedia, and I'll just copy some content out. I'll be sure to put a credit on the bottom of the page, though, because if you use material that isn't your own, you should give credit to whoever you got the material from. Just like if you're writing a paper, right? If you were writing a paper and you quoted a book or an article, you wouldn't pass it off on your own, all right? You would put some sort of indication saying, I got this from such and such page. So let's go and let's create the page. And I'm going to do it in Notepad today. Last time I did it in Notepad++, and it's basically the same. But again, we're using what's called a plain text editor because we really want to get into the guts of the code and really see the way the code works. There are other tools that you can use to create web pages. One of the most popular ones is called Dreamweaver. And it's not that these tools are bad, it's that these tools can be used as a crutch. And you can you can create web pages without really learning the HTML language. And there's some advantages to really learning the language. So we're just going to use a simple text editor like Notepad. So let me go in and pull up Notepad. Now I'm going to start out with the tags that are on every web page. All right, we talked about three or four things that were on every web page. The first of them is a doc type declaration. Now the doc type is not really a tag. It sort of looks like a tag, but strictly speaking, it's a declaration. And that simply tells the browser what it's dealing with. This will tell the browser that we're dealing with an HTML5 document. So that's what this means. There are other doc types for other versions of HTML that look different to this. All right, so that's on every page. Also on every page is an HTML tag that goes around all of the other tags on the page. In computer science kind of terms, this is called the root node, or the root of the document root, and it's the tag that every other tag sits inside. So typically for these sorts of documents, there's one tag could we be sure to keep it down, please? All right. For these sorts of tag, or for these sorts of documents, there's one tag that everything sits inside. And in the case of HTML, it's the HTML tag. Notice what I'm doing is I'm typing. All right. As soon as I put in the start tag, I'll put in the end tag. I think that's an important thing to do, because otherwise you're liable to forget to go and put the ending tag. And if you forget to put the ending tag, again, nothing wrong might happen, but something wrong could happen. So as soon as I put the head tag in, I'm going to go and I'm going to put the end head tag in. And I'm going to do the same thing with the body. All right. Now we talked about the one thing that we know about so far that's going to appear in one thing that's going to appear within the head tag is a title. And that title doesn't appear on the body of the page, but it will appear like on the tab, and it will appear if you minimize the page. So, I'm going to create an H1. It's going to be my page about possums. Could we please keep it down?
Sorry.
And I'm going to have some general information. And I'm going to have what possums eat, which I think is everything. And where they live. So. Let me go to Wikipedia to look this stuff up, because again, I don't know this off the top of my head. Here's my general information. I'm going to copy that into my HTML document. I'm going to put it in a paragraph. Now again, with white space, remember I can make this however I want to. So I can put enters like this to make it easier for me to read. I'm going to get rid of this. Again, I'm doing this simply to make it easier for me to read. I don't have to do this from the browser's perspective. So again, it would have worked if it was one line. It's going to work as separate lines. I pick this because it makes it readable for me. If I wanted to go back and change any of the words, I can see the whole paragraph like this. All right. So let's find habitat. That's where they live. And just to contrast it, this paragraph, I'm not going to put a bunch of enters in. I'll just make it one long line. And you'll see it really won't matter to the browser. Now again, just to be sure, I'm going to put a credit section on this document, which is a good idea to have if you're going to use content from other places. And I'm just going to copy and paste the URL of the Wikipedia page in there. All right. So let's save this. Now again, this is where it gets important to do this correctly. Because I've opened this up in Notepad. I open up Notepad and I put this in. And what I want to do is I want to go and I want to save it. But I have to change this from where it says save as type, because I don't want to save it as a text file or a TXT file. I want to save it as an HTML file. So I would go here and say all files, and I would put in the name I want to save it as. So possum.html. I'm also, just out of convenience, I'm going to save it on the desktop. All right. So I'm going to go here and I'm going to click save. All right. Now again, this is the code. All right. This is sort of the guts, the view of inside the code. The other way that we could view this is by double clicking it, and we can open it up in the browser. So here's my page about possums. Notice, again, my page about possums is the biggest font because it was defined as a top-level heading. All right? General, food, location, and credit are second-level headings, so they're a little smaller. The paragraphs are just plain text because they're just paragraphs. All right? They're not headings at all, so they're just in a normal size of text. Now, again, I can make changes to this if I want. Maybe I'll add another H2 here to say created by the American Possum Society. And notice, I can make the change in this document, save it, and then I can go right back to the browser and refresh, and I'll see my change. All right? Notice how things are nested. The title is within the head. The body contains all the tags that we see in the body of the page, the body of the page being this section here. The title appears up here, and if we minimize it, the title will appear down there. All right? So the title appears in the tab, and when we minimize it, the body are all of the tags that are in the body of the page, that is this section of the page. Any questions about this? So this is sort of a fast-forward version of what we did last time. All right. Questions? All right. Now, Have any of you done any web development prior to this class? Anyone done any web development prior to HTML5? Okay. I'm going to make a couple comments then. And if it doesn't make sense to you, you can just disregard them. All right, if you haven't done any web development before this class, you can disregard them. One of the big things in HTML5 was there was a whole list of new tags created. Again, that's what happens when you get a new version of HTML. They create new tags typically for specific purposes. And one of the things, one of the sets of new tags that were created were tags that describe different sections of a web page. If you go to just about any web page, all right, let's go to all right. There's sort of a heading to the page. There's a navigation to the page. Then there's different articles on the page. And almost any web page sort of fits that mold. Let's go to the one that we went to last time. Might be a little better to illustrate what I'm trying to get at. A list apart. All right. Here's a navigation. What do I mean by navigation? I mean a set of links that take you to different places on the site. Here we have sort of a banner. The banner would be like sort of like the banner in a newspaper, you know, that tells you the Elyria Chronicle or the Collegian. All right, there's a banner that identifies what it is that you're looking at. There then is going to be maybe a series of sections or subsections of the page or articles of the page. And then sometimes there's a footer on the page. In other words, information is important, but they don't really want to emphasize it by putting it like on the top of the page. So they put a lot of the extra stuff sort of on the bottom of the page. And if you go to a lot of different pages, you'll see this pattern repeated over and over. Let's go to Amazon, for example. There's a banner. Tells you what you're at. You're at Amazon. Here's navigation to take you around to different places. Here's a couple of different sections. And again, depending on the kind of site, we could call them sections or we could call them articles. Like a new site, you'd probably call them articles because there's a lot of text. Here there's not a lot of text, so they're probably sections is a better word. And then we have a footer of stuff that appears on the bottom of the page. All right. Prior to HTML5, there was sort of one tag that did all of these things, and that was called the div tag. All right. And it got the job done, but it made for some a little bit of confusing and not straightforward code. So with HTML5, they introduced new tags for these different sections. And what I'm going to do is I'll put those new tags up, and then we'll talk at least about some of them now, and we'll talk about others of them as the semester progresses. The new tags are this. Header tag. Footer. Nav. Section. Article. Aside. I think that's all of them. Maybe missing one. I have that sneaking suspicion that I'm missing one, but I can't remember which one it is, obviously. These describe the different sections of a page. All right. Header relates to sort of the banner on the top of the page. This would be the banner on Cleveland State's page. It's sort of like the thing on a newspaper that tells you what newspaper you're reading. The banner tells you at a glance what page you're on and what the page is about. And that's important. You don't want your user sitting there trying to figure out what kind of page they're on, right? You want it to be obvious that the user's on this page or that page or this organization's site or that organization's site. And you might think that that's obvious, but you know what? I have seen web pages where you stare at them for a minute and you're not 100% sure of the purpose of the page, all right? And therefore, it is important to clearly identify what the page is for and what it's about. And so this stuff is in the header section of the page, all right? And it can consist of headlines, or headings, rather, can consist of images, can consist of any HTML. And again, we haven't covered a lot of tags in HTML, but any tag that we talk about in HTML, you could put in the heading of a page, or a header of a page. Footer is the stuff that's on the bottom of the page, all right? Pretty straightforward. All right, it's the stuff that's important that you want to have on every page, but it's not necessarily so important that you really want to focus on it. So you put all the stuff on the bottom of the page. So that's the first two. Heading sort of identifies the purpose of the page. The nav is a collection of links that take you to other places. All right? And in Cleveland State's example, we saw that at the top of the page there's a set of links that take you to other places. Section, article, and aside all relate to different content on the page. And to some degree, it's not always clear which one to use. I wouldn't worry about it. Just pick one and use it. A section is usually when there is a section of the page, obviously, but it's not necessarily like an article where there's a lot of text. An article is like where there's a lot of text. And an aside is where there's an article that sort of relates to another article. For example, if there was an article about possums, on a website about possums, there might be an aside that talks about other marsupials, like kangaroos and, I don't know, wombats, or whatever other marsupials there are in the world. So it's like, not really the main topic, but it's related to it. It kind of is like if you've ever seen in like an article in a magazine, they might have an article about, you know, a particular subject. Then they have sort of like a side article about a particular aspect of it. Like, for example, if there was a movie review or an article about the movie Wonder Woman, there might be an aside article that talks about the actress that plays Wonder Woman off to the side. So it's like related to the main article, but they put it out to the side because it's sort of like a tangent. All right. So that's what you use an aside for. So all three of these relate to content on the page. This is content that isn't necessarily a lot of text. This is content that's a lot of text. And this is content that sort of related to other stuff on the page. All right, sort of in a secondary way. So let's look at our page that we created on possums and see how we can use these tags. Well, header would be what? Header would be, let me go and open my page in Notepad again. And I can open it a couple different ways. One way I can do it is by opening up Notepad then saying file open, again switching to all files, and then finding my HTML page and open. What do you think these two tags would be considered? Yeah, this is a header. Again, what does a header do? It sort of identifies like the purpose of the page. Who made the page, what's the page about, and so on. So these two would probably be the header of the page. All right. Down here, the credits. Whoops. That probably would be good to be as a footer. One thing that you'll notice as we create more of these pages, especially when we start creating not just single pages, but a set of pages that work together as a site, is it's important to have certain things on the site consistent. Like you want to have your heading consistent, you want to have your header consistent, you want to have your navigation consistent, you want to have your footer consistent. Because that really helps the user in figuring out where they need to go on your website. All right? So, I'm going to put my credit about where I got my information in the footer. And again, I'm going to indent to show proper nesting. The H1 and H2 are part of the header. This H2 and paragraph are part of the footer. All right. Each of these things, you could call them sections or you could call them articles, right? It's not really worth worrying too much which one you do, right? I would call them articles because they're mainly text. All right. So I'm going to create an article tag here. An article tag here. And an article tag here. All right. So we've divided this page into what we had before, into a header, three articles, and a footer. All right. These other things, nav, well, we don't have any links, so we don't have a nav yet. All right. Section, we could have called those articles sections, but we didn't. We chose to call them articles because they were mainly text. And asides, right now I don't have any asides on that page. I might go, depending on how the lecture goes today, I might go and add an aside later on. Now, let's notice, we made this change, let's notice the difference it makes in the web page. And you might be surprised to see that it makes absolutely no difference in the appearance of the page. All right? Why did I bother doing it then if it doesn't make a difference? Well, we're sort of setting up so that we can do some good things later on. All right? The better that you describe the way your page is structured, the better that you use the tags to say exactly what's on the page, what things belong together in a section, and so on, the better you'll have to do an effective job later on when we start styling this page. Right? What do I mean by styling the page? I mean when we start adding CSS code to the page and we start making the page look different than the defaults. Remember, we haven't put any CSS code on this page. We haven't really talked about CSS. So our page looks very, very, very basic and generic. This page is taking all the defaults for the browser. So defaults for the H1s, defaults for the H2, defaults for paragraphs, all those defaults is simply displaying that. Now, we're likely to want to change this to give it a more attractive look, to make the page easier to identify. For example, this credit information is different than these other articles, right? We might want that the credits and the heading to look different, to make them stand out, so that people at a glance can tell that this information down here is a little different than this information here and here and here. All three of these are just basic articles about possums. This is a little bit different. It's telling us where we got our information from. So we might want that to look a little different. Sort of a fundamental rule of web design is stuff that means the same thing or stuff that's sort of the same thing, you want to look the same. Stuff that is different, you want to look different. So I might want to, later on, when I get in the CSS code, style the heading section to look, or header section to look different than the articles, and the footer to look different than the header and the articles. All right? Now, I know it's a little confusing because we have a head and a header. Remember, the head is part of the HTML document along with the body. The header relates to a section of the page that's sort of the banner or displaying what the page is about and so on. Any questions about this? All right. So again, even though it doesn't have a visible effect right now, it will be beneficial to us the better that we can describe it. Another thing to keep in mind, and I'm not going to really dwell on it now, is that there are a lot of things other than humans that read web pages, believe it or not. What do I mean? Do cats read web pages? Do Martians read web pages? What do you think I mean by something other than a human reading a web page? What other than a human would be reading a web page? Other computers, right. Most famously, Google. How do you think Google knows where to find the pages about possums and about maple trees and about maple syrup and about Canada and about Mexico and so on? It knows because Google goes out there and crawls the web and looks up web pages. It finds web pages, it reads the web pages, and it creates a giant directory of web pages. So if you do a search on maple syrup, it knows what pages relate to maple syrup. How does it do this? I don't know. That's why those people are billionaires, right? It has this really elaborate way of figuring out how to make a directory for these things. But the thing is that other computers read your web page. And the better job you do using your tags to create your web page, the easier it will be for other computers to read your page. So that's why, even though it's not obvious why we need these tags right now, they are very important. Okay. Questions about any of this? All right, links. We're going to talk about links because right now we put our credit on the bottom of the page to say this information is from this page, but it'd be nice if we could click on that and we could go to that page, right? As it is now, it's just plain text. It's not a link. Why is it just plain text? Because we haven't put a tag in to tell the browser this ought to be a link. All right? Remember, that's how you do anything on a web page. How do you make something a link? You use a tag for a link. How do I make something an image? Use a tag for an image. How do I make something a header, all right, a headline? Use a tag for a headline. So, what is the tag for a link? The tag for a link is the A tag. And the A stands for anchor. I don't know why they came up with this. Just like I don't know why they called it a header and a head and all that. It's a little confusing, but I'm just teaching this stuff. I didn't make it up. All right? So, the A is a tag for a link. Now, I'm going to want to make my link look something like this, but there's something missing. I'm going to type in the start of a link But there's going to be something missing. And I want you to see if you can figure out what's missing. So this is sort of part of what I need to do. So I want to say on in my footer, instead of putting in down here info from the URL, I want a link that says info from Wikipedia's page about possums. So that's what I want the text to read. So, what's missing from this? What don't you see up here? Repeat, please. Yeah, the actual URL that you have to go to, right? Right. It's missing the URL that you have to go to. If you don't put the URL in, how does the browser know where to take you? How many pages do you think there are on the web? Let's count. All right. Learning Communities, ESP, Cleveland. There's a lot. All right. There's literally billions of web pages on the web. That's not like an exaggeration. So how does a browser know which of those billion pages you want to go to? Well, you have to tell it, of course. How do you tell it? This tells it that this is a link. How do you tell it what it's a link to? That is where we're going to add something to the tag that's different than anything we've seen before. And the thing that we're adding to the tag is called an attribute. All right? Remember I said sometimes there's other stuff between the greater than or the less than and greater than sign other than the name of the tag? Attributes are what that other stuff is. And what's an attribute? An attribute is additional information about the tag that is needed to make the tag work the way that it's supposed to. So the A says that it's a link. The href says a link to what? Here's where you put the URL in. So the full link tag that we're going to have is going to look like this. Less than sign A. A space, then href equals, and then enclosed in quotes, the URL. So every link needs an href attribute. The href tells the link, tells the browser, the actual URL that we want to go to. Because it's not enough to say, hey, I got a link. You have to say a link to what? Okay, exactly. A link to where we're going to. So it's not enough to say a link. The H1, that's all we need to do is say, yeah, I want this to be a top-level headline. That's all the information we have to give it. And here's the content of the headline. Same thing with the H2, same thing with the paragraphs. None of these other things needed attributes, but the link needs an attribute. Additional information. Now, all the attributes that we're going to see in this class are going to look like this. They're going to be part of the start tag. You don't need them on the ending tag. You just need to put them in once on the start tag. They're between the less than and greater than sign. And they're going to be the name of the attribute, which are predefined, right? I didn't make up href. Href is the predefined attribute name. So you have the name of the attribute, an equal sign, and then enclosed in quotes, you're going to have the value of that attribute. Now we're going to see an attribute when we look at the image tag. It'll be a very similar thing, right? If we say we have an image on the page, we have to say the name of the file that contains that image. Because which image is it? Our website could have hundreds of images. We have to specify what image we want to display. So when we use an image tag, when we learn about that, probably beginning of next week, all right, we will have an attribute to say, well, I want an image, and this is the name of the image I want to put in here. This is the file that contains the image that I want to put in there. In the case of the link, it's the URL that we want to link to. All right? So I'm going to go and put that in here. Just going to copy and paste it. And again, here's the nice thing is I can indent this however I see fit to make it more readable. In this case, notice that the link is part of the paragraph. So I use the indenting of that link to show you that that link is part of that paragraph. It's nested within the paragraph. What do I mean by nested? I mean it starts within the paragraph tag and it ends within the paragraph tag, so it's properly nested. So now when I go and save this and hit refresh, if I click on this, I go to that page. And I can use the back button to go back. Now notice that that page is maroon, or I think that's actually magenta. All right. How did the browser decide to make it magenta? Well, again, we haven't put any CSS code in, so the browser uses defaults. Defaults for links are blue or magenta, depending on if you visited the link or not. If you have not visited a link, the link will be blue. So if I were to go in and add a link to add a link to Oberlin College's website. I have not visited that today on this machine. Notice that the link to Oberlin is blue, all right, because I haven't visited it yet. The link to the Possum Wikipedia page is magenta because I have visited that yet. Now, if I go here to Oberlin's website and then I go back, notice it gets changed to magenta. This is, again, the default behavior of the browser, all right? So I'm going to delete this. We don't really need it anymore. So the key thing about links is the addition of a new bit about HTML, and that's the attribute. And the attribute, again, says a link to what? Attributes are additional information that needs to be supplied to the browser. You are not going to have an A tag without an attribute for the href. In fact, if I do that, if I forget, what happens? The browser doesn't even recognize it as a link because we haven't set a link to where. So it just displays it as plain text. If we put the link back in, the URL back in, it then recognizes it as a link. So by default, the link is going to be underlined, and it's either going to be blue or magenta, depending on whether you visited it or not. Now, one thing that we can do that is sometimes done is we can link to different sections of the page. This is often done with frequently asked questions. All right? Many of you have probably seen frequently asked questions pages. Let's see if Amazon has one. Not really. Oh, here's another good example. It's not a frequently asked page. Let's actually just go to our possum page. Here, I'm looking for another page, and this possum page has exactly what I'm looking for. Notice this, habitat. Habitat is not another page. What is habitat? It's a different section of this page. So if I click on habitat, it jumps me to the section. I'm still on the same page. Now notice the URL changed a little bit. There's a pound sign and the word habitat there. Likewise, if I click on classifications, boom, it takes me to that section of the page. So you could have links to a separate web page, or you can have links to a section of your web page. So that's what I'm going to do now, is I'm going to create links to the section, different sections of my web page. And this is going to be my page's navigation. All right, just like this is this page's navigation. So if you think about navigation, navigation is really a list of links, right? That's really what a navigation is. So we learned about lists last time. Now, did I have to put these in this order? Not really. I just sort of the order off the top of my head. General information, food, location. So that's not really an ordered list. All right? It's not in any specific order. It's in the order that I just happen to choose. So I will use an unordered list to describe these links. All right? So, I'm going to put my nav section up here. I'm going to create a list that's an unordered list. Notice what I'm doing is as soon as I put them in, I'm putting in the ending tag. And notice how neatly I'm indenting these things. All right? Should be pretty obvious to you just after a day and a half of class that I'm not particularly a neat person. All right? My shirt is never tucked in, my hair is rarely combed, and so on. So I'm not really one of them neat fanatics. All right? Yet, look at my code. Look how neat it is. All right? Why is it? Because it's important to keep your code neat. All right? It's important to keep your code neat so that when you go back later on, you can read your code and easily make changes to it. So, I'm indenting this UL. So, at a glance, I can see that the UL is nested within the nav section. All right? So, UL for unordered list. A list consists of list items. I have three list items, general, food, and habitat.
Habitat, yep.
Now if I go and display this, sure enough I'm going to have my list, but those lists aren't links. So I got my list, but those lists aren't links. All right. Now, what can I do to correct that? Well, I can put as part of the list the link tag. Well, if you remember what I said before, I need an href there. Now, this doesn't have its own URL because it's not a separate web page. It's a section of this web page. So what do we do? All right. What we actually do is this. We can define different we can give a name, or we can identify sections of the page by using what's called an ID. And by using an ID, we can then specify, I want a link to that spot of the page. So here's what I'm going to do. On the first article, I'm going to say ID equals gen for general. All right? This article, I'm going to say ID equals food. And this one, I'm going to say ID equals location. Actually, I have location, not habitat. So let me go and change that. So I've given these sections an ID. To create a link to it, I use the pound sign and the name of the ID. So href equals pound sign gen. What that tells the browser is, go to that section of the page that has an ID of gen, G-E-N, and bring that to the top of the page. Okay, so I have href equals pound sign gen. That'll take me to this page, this part of the page. ID equals food, that'll take me to this part of the page. ID equals LOC, that'll take me to that part of the page. So I go and save it and hit refresh. Now notice those things are links. And in fact, they're blue. Why are they blue? Because I have not gone to that specific section of the page yet. So if I click on general, food or location, I'm actually going to make the browser window smaller so that we can see this. If I click on food, notice what happens. Food jumps to the top. If I click on location, location jumps to where it's visible. I'll also add one for the credits. On credits, that jumps to where it's visible. All right. So that's another way that you can have links. And it's especially valuable when you have like a long page that has a bunch of subsections in it. That's why I originally was going to look for an FAQ page, right? Because frequently asked question pages, there might be a dozen or so page. Each question, or dozen or so questions on the frequently asked questions page. Each question might have a couple paragraphs for the answer. So the page is very long. So if you want to find the answer to the 12th frequently asked question, you don't necessarily want to scroll all the way down to the 12th question. It's nice if you can just click the link and just immediately jump there. So you could create sort of a mini navigation within your page. All right? Now, the other thing that we can do is we can put a link back to the top of the page. Because if I don't want to scroll all the way down to the 12th frequently asked question, I also don't want to scroll back up to the top. I want a link to go back to the top. And how do I do that? Again, it's a link, so it's an A. It has to have an href, so I put my href in. What is back to the top? Back to the top is the pound sign by itself. I still call that the pound sign and not hashtag. If you're a musician, I guess that's a sharp symbol too. So I guess you could pick any of those. Doesn't matter what you call it as long as you get it right. So I can put the back to the top. So if I jump down to the credits, I can click back to the top and go back to the top of the page. So I have a little navigation within the page to jump around to different sections of it and jump back up to the top. Now notice again, I made little changes. Like originally I called the link habitat instead of location. But I made sure I went back once I realized that I called the article location. I went back and changed the link to be location. Those little things matter on a website, because if you call something one thing in one place and a different thing someplace else, that can be very confusing to the users. So therefore, try to keep a consistent terminology. If you call it habitat in one place, call it habitat in both places. If you call it location in one place, call it location in the other. All right, very important to keep consistency, because otherwise users will liable to think, well, what's the difference between habitat and location, and you're going to confuse them, and so on. So it's very important to keep things consistent in your website. Consistency is one of the, again, big design principles. All right. We haven't talked too much in this class yet about designing a web page. Designing a web page is really a lot more than just picking out nice colors and fonts and things like that. Designing a web page really relates to how you're going to organize the material on the page. All right? How you're going to, and when you get into larger projects, how you're going to organize the material on an entire site. How are you going to break it down? Are you going to have 5 pages or 10 pages? What pages are you going to have? How are you going to divide your topic up, and so on? And consistency is important. Things like keeping the header the same on every page is important. Keeping the footer the same. The navigation the same. All those kind of things that you do for consistency are very important for the user, because it really helps the user get around the website. Then they really understand and they're not confused about, well, I was on the location page. Is that the same as the habitat page or not? You know, it's a much better way, much better experience for the user if you keep things consistent. So you want your pages to look consistent. If your header is in a certain place on one page, you want the header to be in that same page on every page, same place on every page. Likewise, navigation, footer, and so on. These are two different kinds of links. We're going to talk about a couple other different kinds of links. One of the other kinds of links we're going to save until next time, but the last link we're going to talk about today is an email link. So, for example, I could put in my footer, any questions, email Mike Zellers, or email. I could put my email address here. All right. If I did that, sort of like with the Wikipedia page. It's there, but it's not a link.
No, it's not.
I could go in and put and make this a link by saying E or href equals, and then say email colon, and then put the email address. Now, this isn't going to work on this machine because email has not been set up. Microsoft Outlook has not been set up on this machine, but I can sort of show you what's going to happen. So now, notice that it's a link. And if I click on it, it's not email. I lied. It's mail too. Now when I click the link, you'll notice that it brings up the different email programs on this machine. Again, the email isn't defined on this machine, but if it was defined on a person's machine, it would open up Outlook and create an email to that address. So all the user would have to do is fill in the subject and type in their email and be able to send it. I'll pick out Outlook, and I don't think Outlook is set up, so it will, it takes me to the setup screen for Outlook. All right, so we've seen three different href options so far, and there's at least a couple other ones that we'll talk about. One of them, one of the email href options that we've seen is when we have a page on someone else's website, and that we put in the full URL that will start with HTTP or HTTPS. You have to put the HTTPS in. If I did just this, it wouldn't work. It would think that that's a page on my computer, and it would not display it. So I need the full HTTPS. Usually what I do is I'll bring up the page and I'll simply copy and paste into my code. So the URL of a different page is one of the possibilities. All right. The other possibility is I can link to a section of the page, and you do that by putting pound sign and the name of the ID of that section. ID equals Jen, ID equals food, ID equals LOC, ID equals credit. That's the second kind of URL, second kind of href we could use. The third kind of URL that we can use is we can use a mail to and put someone's email in. And that will open up their email application and create an email for them. Now, the one thing we'll talk about next week you need for your lab too, and that is how to create a link to a second page that you created. We'll talk about that probably on Tuesday of next week. All right. What I want to do about the remaining time is I want to talk a little bit about design, and I want to talk a little bit about CSS. This will be our introduction. Because everyone's web pages, until we start talking about CSS, are going to look exactly like this, right? They're going to be white background, black font, and all that. When I talk about web design, again, I'm not talking just about, like, gee, what colors do I think are the best looking and things like that. How can I have my page look nice? Certainly, that's a goal. Right? Of course we want a page that looks nice. All right, that's definitely a goal. It's like you want a car that looks nice. All right, but there's more things about the design of a car than the way it looks. Right, there's how the engine is designed, so how efficient it is for fuel. That has to be designed, right? You know, by designed I mean planned out. They have to figure out how to make the engine so that it is fuel efficient. They have to figure out how to make the car so it's safe. They have to figure out how to make the car so it's comfortable. They have to figure out how to put the controls so that the driver can really see and reach all the controls that you need. All those things are aspects of the design. So when you talk about the design of the car, you're not just talking about how nice the car looks. You're talking about all those things. And it's the same thing for websites. Making your site and pages more functional for the user, easier for the user to use, is a key aspect of design. And how do you do that? Well, you do that by thinking through how you're going to organize the material on your page, by sketching it out. Like, for example, this possum page, I just sort of went off the top of my head, but really, what I should do, and the more HTML we learn, the more options you'll have, but really what you should do is you should sketch out the page and say what you want it to look like. That I want a banner on the top of the page. I then want general information in a block. I want information about the food and so on. And then finally, my footer. You want to plan out how that is. Now, the pages that we're working on now are pretty simple, so they're not going to require extensive planning. But it's good to get in the habit of thinking through how you want to organize a page. Like, for example, for your second lab assignment, or part two of the first lab assignment, whatever topic that you pick, think about how you want to separate it out into like subtopics and how you want to organize the information on the page to make it easier for the users to understand. You know, look at this page. If I came to this page and I just wanted to know what to feed my possum, I could click the food and jump right to that. If I had just one giant paragraph with all the stuff in it, that wouldn't be very well organized. And a person would have to read the entire page to get the information. Whereas this allows people to see what they're looking for and jump right to that specific spot of the page. Now, we can do other things with the appearance of the page to make the design work better, right? So it's not just about pretty colors, but it's about using colors to emphasize certain things, to make some things stand out. All right. We might want, for example, the banner on the top of the page to stand out. We might want the footer on the bottom of the page to stand out. These are all things that we can do to sort of organize the material on our page so that it doesn't just look better, but it makes it easier for the users to be able to scan the page and find the stuff that they want. It just makes the pages more usable in the first place. So the first thing we're going to do deals with changing the colors of our web page. All right? Because usually that's the most obvious thing that we can do. All right? Because, you know, with fonts, we could change the font, and you might have to look closely to see if the font really changed or not. But with colors, it's usually pretty obvious. And we're going to keep this simple, all right, to start out with. But keep in mind that just about anything on the page that we can put in to our HTML, we can change the way it looks through CSS. We're going to start out changing the color. All right. This code also is going to live in the head section because it's not something we display in the body of the page, the CSS code that we're going to have. Right now, I'm going to put a style tag in. Well, you have to guess what I'm typing now. You can't tell by the key clicks what I'm typing. Thank you. I do that typically once or twice or 10 times per class. So thank you for pointing that out. My meaner classes let me go a long time and then say, by the way, you were on the projector for the past hour, you know. All right. So I put in the head section a style tag. That tells the browser the code from here and here is not HTML, it's CSS. We're in CSS land. We're not in HTML land. So the browser will understand that that code is CSS code and not HTML code. Later on, like next week, we'll learn about how we can put our CSS in a separate file. And that's actually really cool. It's really cool because then we can put in a separate CSS file, we can put all our CSS code, use that CSS file on every single one of our pages, and change the way our entire site looks like simply by changing one file. And that's great. Why is that great? Because it makes things easy to change. I did some work ages ago at the Kay Jewelers website. All right, and Kay Jewelers, as you might imagine, different times of the year they have different sorts of specials going on. Right? You know, during February they have Valentine's Day specials and May Mother's Day specials and December holiday specials and all that. So they would want their color scheme to change with the different times of the year, all right? Simply to just make it, you know, a little more reinforcing the notion that, hey, Valentine's Day is coming out, folks, buy something for, your Valentine. All right. Now, the Kay Jewelers website has a whole bunch of pages on it, all right? It would be very difficult if we had to go back and change every single one of those pages to change it to be holiday themed or to change it to be Valentine's Day themed or whatever. But fortunately, we coded it in a way where the CSS was in its own file. So we didn't have to go and change 500 pages. We changed one CSS file to say, hey, use pink and red instead of red and green. And it changed the entire site to have a Valentine's Day look instead of a Christmas look. All right. But we'll do that next week. Right now, I'm going to put my CSS code right in my HTML file. CSS consists of a set of rules. The rules have two parts. They have what's called the selector, and then they have the rule part. All right? So I'm going to keep things easy, and I'm going to say this. Header. Background red, color, well, let's just do background red for now. What do you think this is going to do to my web page? Well, it's going to make the header red. What's the header? Well, it's the stuff that's in the header tag. So in this style rule, the header relates to the HTML tag that I want to change the appearance of. That's called the selector. And there's a whole bunch of different kinds of selectors that you have in CSS. The simplest selector is the HTML tag. Header means that any header on my page, and typically you only have one header, but you could have more than one header. It wouldn't really make sense, but you could. All right. It is going to change this about it. It's going to make the background red. Now, the CSS changes that it's going to make are included in these braces. We have the thing that we want to change, a colon, and then the value we want to change it to. If I go and do this, if I save that and refresh that, we have our header has a background that's red. Nothing else in the page changed. How does the rest of it know to be white with black font? Well, that's the browser defaults. So this is the first example of what I described last time. The way the page looks depends on the CSS code that you write and the browser defaults. Now, the way the browser works is if you put in a CSS rule, it assumes that it overrides the browser default. So by default, everything on this page has a white background and black font. All right? But by me putting a CSS rule to say that that header has a background of red, that will change the background to red. That will override the browser's default. So, header is the tag. That's the selector. So, the thing that has a header, thing that has a tag of header, that's the thing that we're going to change. What are we going to change about it? Well, those things are, those attributes are listed in the braces. The background, we're going to change to be red. What if I were to change this? What's that going to change? Well, every H2 on the page is going to be red. So all the H2s are going to be red. Now, if you notice, this does a couple things. I mean, I wouldn't describe this as a work of art, but it looks a little nicer than it did before. We have a little color in it. It's not quite as boring.
Yeah,
but it also organizes the page visually into sections.
Yeah.
So instead of seeing just one giant blob of stuff, we can see the different sections on the page. Again, keep in mind we do things not just to make things look nice, but we do things to help our user visually organize the stuff on the page. Now, right now, we've changed, by putting in H2 as a selector, we change every H2 on our page. I'm not going to cover right now what if we don't want every H2 to be changed, but there's ways to do that too. Because maybe sometimes we don't want literally every H2. We maybe just want some of the H2s. But we'll talk about later on how we do that. All right? So I could do something like this. I could say by H1, I want a background of yellow. And that's our page. That makes the H1 on top stand out, and the H2 stand out as well. Now, we can change more than one attribute at a time if we want. So, for example, if I want to change both the background color and the color of text, I can say background red, color white, for example. And that will change both the background color and the color of the page. Now, I'm not spending a lot of time picking out nice colors in this example. I'm just picking the basic colors, red, yellow, you know, and so on. Next week, we'll talk about how to choose good colors. Some people have a knack for choosing good colors, right? They just, you know, they know what colors go together, and they're able to pick them, all right? A lot of people don't have that knack, though. Fortunately, there's a lot of science that's involved in what colors go well together. And we can use tools that will help us pick good colors, all right? And we'll talk about that next time as well, all right? The important thing to recognize is that we can change every piece of the page to look different. Now, here is where, as was stated in the movie Spider-Man, with great power comes great responsibility, right? Because we could make everything on the page a different color if we wanted to. Let's go and do it just for laughs. I could go in and say, the paragraphs I want to be purple. and the color white, or color yellow. The UL, I could have a background. Of green and a color of red. And the footer, we could have a background of blue and a color of green. We can go and change everything on the page. Does that make it a better page? No.
No, that does not look like a better page.
That is not a better page. We'd be better off if we just left it a black and white page, right? And that's one of the key things for design. Don't overkill, right? You want to put things on your page. You want to use colors on your page. You want to use different fonts, but you want to use it in a way that really emphasizes things and makes things clear to the user and helps the user visually organize the stuff that's on the page. If you overkill with the page, then nothing really stands out because everything's a different color. All right? It's like a person that screams all the time. Person that screams all the time, you can never tell when they're upset because they're always screaming. All right? Therefore, you want to use colors and fonts and really everything that we talk about, not just because you can, but to emphasize things. So what I think would be good, a nice, maybe subtle way to emphasize things on this page, would simply to make every H2 a different color. And I'm going to go and make it gray instead of red, because red's a little bright. Now it's starting to look better than it did before, right? Because it's not overkill, all right? And yet, the little bit of change in color just made the page organized a little bit easier for the users to read and to understand. Now, I typed in just color names off the top of my head, red, green, yellow, gray, and so on. There's actually a lot of colors that you can define via HTML. All different sorts of shades of green and red and so on. And we'll learn how to refer to the different shades of colors. Because basic colors have names. And there's a whole bunch of names for colors that you can use. But there's also a bunch of colors that don't have names that you use a certain code, and we'll study that code next time. As far as color names go, here's a list of color names that exist. Alice Blue, Antique White, Aqua, Aquamarine, Azure, Beige, Bisque, and so on. So these are all colors that you can use just by putting their name in. Let's use one of them. Let's use, what would be nice for this? Let's use teal. All right, and that's how it looks. Probably didn't look too much different. If you look at it on a monitor, you can tell a little better how it looks. But there's a lot more colors than there are names for colors, and we'll study how to come up with a good set of colors next time. We'll review how to put our CSS code into a different file, and we'll study how to create a second HTML page that we can link to that's not out on the web, but a page of our own creation. That's what we'll do next time, next week in class. Are there any questions at this point? All right. I will upload this, and then I will see you over in lab.